Now we gradually approaching the main topic of our course, finding minimum of a function. And first, let us define what is minimum. And here immediately we will start with distinguishing of global and local minima. I start from a plot. Here's plot of some function defined over set C. And these points we call local minima, and these points we call global minima. So local minima means that in the neighborhood of a point, it has the lowest value. And global minima, of course, the value is the lowest over all set C. And here's formal definition. So we have a function over subset in Rn, and minimum is global over set C if for any point y from C f of x less or equal to y. Less or equal is important. So you may have constant function, and all points will be global minima. Okay, and what is definition of local minimum? That around point I can take some ball, some area, small area, and in this area the value will be minimal. And here is the formal definition. So x in C is a local minimum of f over set C if epsilon exists, some small number epsilon, that f of x less or equal f of y for any y from this notion of epsilon ball around x intersection with C. This is important, because you see, this is also local minimum. It doesn't look like this local minimum, but if we will take some small area around this point, intersection of this ball with C, this point will be the lowest. All other points belonging to C will, in this area, you'll have a larger value. So this intersection is important. And okay, and here is just definition of epsilon ball. Pay attention that it defined with respect to some norms. So there are many various balls. The most typical is Euclidean norm, Euclidean ball, usual ball when you use L2 norm, but you can use also other norms. And actually definition is equivalent if x is restricted in one norm, it's also restricted in all other norms. When our function is convex, the situation with global and local minima is much better than for general function. This is clear even for from one dimensional picture. F of x, the convex function looks like this. Okay, in my picture we have one local and global minimum, and it cannot look like this. So this function is not convex. Why do I know this? It's by definition. If I take any two points, then connecting line should be above function plot. Okay, and he is not. So the situation of multiple local minima is not for convex function, And we can show this formally. This is our first claim. For a convex function, any local minimum is also a global one. Why I say any local? Because the convex function may have also flat minimum. For example, this is constant, and it may increase or may not increase in the right hand side. Then so all these points, all this are minima. Okay, so there are many local minima, and each of them is global one. We will show in a second this formally, following just from definition of convex function. And the second claim is that if convex function is strictly convex, then it has at most one global minimum. Pay attention that it at most one. So it's either or has one global minimum or may have no global minimum. Let's try to understand this again graphically. Strictly convex function should be strictly below linear function between any two points. So this gives us intuition that minimum cannot be flat. On the other hand, I can easily draw example of strictly convex function which doesn't have minimum at all. For example, function like 1 over x. Okay? It decreases at every point, it's strictly convex. It has infinum, it has a lower bound, title lower bound. But it has no concrete x which is a minimizer. It should be infinity, but we don't consider this case as number f as a point which minimizes. Okay, so those are two properties. And let me, for example, show by definition of convex function how can we prove the first one. So we say that I have f from convex set in Rn to R. C is convex set, and so my proof will be by contradiction. I suppose that x is a local minimum which is not global one. If not global one, then in C exists some other point y where f of y is strictly less than f of x. And here I draw some picture. So, for example, x and y are two points on the plane. And I was thinking about x as local minimum. I was thinking that my if x is local minimum, then along any line, my function should behave like this. It should have minimum at x. Okay, but on other hand, convex function along any line should be below linear function which connects function values on this line. And if value in y is lower than value in x, I know that my function f should be below this. It cannot grow because linear function always decreases from x to y if value in y is smaller than value in x. My function f should be below this linear, so it cannot increase in the point f. And this will bring me to contradiction. Again, let's follow formally. F of y is less than f of x, then by definition of convex function, a long line connecting y and x, my function is smaller than linear function. And alpha is the scalar which controls my movement along this line, so alpha is between 0 and 1. So I say that my function must be below this linear function, and this term is always negative because f of y is less than f of x and alpha is positive. That's why I know that for any ball around x, f of the there will be such that along line, along my line, that f of z is below f of x. Again, for any ball, some piece of my line will be inside of ball. And every point on the line will have a function less than f of x. So, therefore, I get to a contradiction. So, from here, I say that x is not a local mean, and this gives me a contradiction. With my primary assumption, and this accomplishes the proof of this theorem, and the proof of the property 2, that strictly convex function has at most one global minimum. So again, the proof will follow by contradiction. We suppose that x, y are two global minima, and with value f of x is equal to f of y to some number mu. And consider point z in between of those two. By strong convexity, go to definition and see that I wrote the same for alpha is 1/2 from the lecture where definition of strong convexity was done. So by strong convexity, value in the point in between is strictly less than value of linear function, which is written here. And what is written here is mu plus mu divided by 2 is mu. So f of z is less than f of x, for example, and also f of y. And it contradicts our assumption that x and y are global minima. So we proved the property 2 as well. Now we are ready to consider optimality conditions. Answering the question, what can we say about gradient and possibly Hessian if we know that point x is optimal? And opposite question, if we know something special about gradient and Hessian, whether can we say about the point that it is optimal? It's necessary, first of all, was necessary, and the second is sufficient conditions. So necessary, if x is optimal, then something is said about gradient and probably Hessian, and the sufficient, if something we know about Hessian or gradient, we can definitely say that x is optimal. And we will start with the basic condition which for convex function it is sufficient and necessary. So if we know that at some point gradient of convex function over which is defined over entire space Rn is zero, then this x star is optimal. And vice versa, if x star is optimal, then gradient should be zero. And it's rather clear. First of all, I show, as usual, a graphical example. So this is plot of convex function, and this is a minimal point. And we can see the tangent line is horizontal. So if tangent line is horizontal, which is defined by derivative in our 1D dimensional case, and in multi-dimensional case this will be plane and it's defined by gradient. So when derivative or gradient is zero, this plane is constant, and my function is above this constant, so x star is minimal. And saying formally, this is by gradient inequality. So we say gradient inequality tells us that if we move from x star gives some increment r, then function greater than linear function defined by in this way, linear function of r. But we say that gradient is zero at x star, and then our function in any other point is greater or equal to the function in point x star. This proves that x star is an optimal point. And if our function is not convex, not necessarily convex, then gradient equal to zero is a necessary but not sufficient condition of optimality. I mean, if x is optimal and function is smooth, of course, differentiable, the gradient must be zero, like in this example, one-dimensional example of x squared. But if gradient is zero, like function x cubed, we don't know. We maybe not in minimum, and even maybe in maximum of our function. But if we are in minimum of smooth function, then gradient is zero. So that's why it's called necessary condition. And also we can say something about curvature, about second derivative. It should be greater or equal to zero. Why I say greater or equal or not just greater? Because for example, if I would have a function x to the power 4, it would have the same minimum, but the second derivative would be 0. On the other hand, greater or equal 0 second derivative doesn't guarantee that point is optimal. For example, here the derivative is second derivative is zero, and the point is not optimal. So again, it's only necessary condition. So if my function is twice differentiable, that I know that there must not be direction of negative curvature. And in multidimensional case, it says that in any direction r, there should not be negative second derivative, which we know already expression of the second derivative using Hessian. It means that for any vector r, this product should be greater or equal to zero. In the same words, matrix of Hessian should be positive semi-definite in this solution. You remember, it reminds a bit similar requirement which we had for convex function. But here it's used as a necessary condition of optimality. And also we can write the sufficient optimality condition. It says the following: if I have a smooth function, smooth continuously twice differentiable function, and I know that at some point it's gradient zero, and sorry, it's Hessian. It's Hessian. Positive definite. Then I know that this point is a local minimum. And how can one rather fast to get idea of proof if Hessian is function is twice continuously differentiable and Hessian is strictly positive at some point, it also strictly positive at some neighborhood of this point. And I can draw a convex neighborhood of this point, and the function in this neighborhood will be convex. We know that if Hessian is positive definite over domain of the function, now we have this other function, small domain, small convex domain. If Hessian is positive definite, then function is convex. And for convex function, this is a sufficient optimality condition. It's like I only give you a rough idea of thinking and suggest you at home write down a formal proof of this fact. And by this, we finish our topic of optimality condition. We'll move to the main issue, the main topic of the course, optimization algorithms.